Built for Speed by John McGuinness. Read by Joe McGann. Foreword by Guy Martin. It's early March, and me, John, and the Honda team are out testing the new Fireblade in the sun. It's going okay. There's a few niggles to sort, but I got to tinker on the bikes, and John even trusted me enough to take a spanner to his, so I think that's a good sign of things to come. At this point, John asks a favour. Would I write a foreword for his new book? John is the man, so I say, aye. As long as I can have a bit of input from the boss, and that is Nigel the dog. John looked at me like my potato bravas were a bit too spicy last night, but just says, yeah, whatever. John hasn't really met Nigel yet. He'll see. I give Nigel a call and the conversation goes a bit like this. Guy. Now, boy, what's happening? Not much to report here. The Fireblade's going well, and the team are mega. John has asked a favour, though. Can we write a foreword for his book? There's a deep sigh on the other end of the phone. Oh, dear. What's up? You do know that people ask their celebrity friends to write forewords, which means McPint has put you in the celebrity category with his F1 mate and that one from the Bake Off. What? John knocks about with the old bird. Yeah, Dad. A bit of Enduro in the morning together, and supposedly Mary has taught him how to make a mean Victoria sponge. Right, interesting weekend then. Yeah, Dad. What do I think of John? John McGuinness will be remembered as an all-time TT legend when he finally retires. The man has 23 wins under his belt and he's chasing down Joey's 26th win record, so I don't see him retiring any time soon. Do I think he can do it? Never underestimate John. I don't know if anyone knows the course as well as him. Sometimes at the beginning of the week you think, ah, he has lost it, as he's got no wins. Then he finally arrives at the senior, and you can't beat him for love nor money. We like John. He seems really happy in his lot. Maybe I envy that a bit. He's happy with not chasing something bigger and better every week. He loves the TT. That's his drug of choice. He chases the wins. He isn't the fittest of lads, but you can't really argue that beer and pie should be taken off the pre-TT training diet plan, as the results speak for themselves. Perhaps we need to get the pies in you. Maybe I can get his mate Mary to give us a recipe then. We both wish John all the best with the book. It's a great read, and John is as down to earth as they come, even when he rocks up in his superstar motorhome. He's quick-witted, and I like the banter. I'm looking forward to being his teammate, and I hope you all enjoy the read. Nige, anything to add? Hang about. What's this rubbish about being just a brickie for Morecambe? More chances of you laying an egg than a brick, mate. Guy and Nige. Becky McGuinness on John McGuinness. I've held John McGuinness's hand in his spare visors for more than 350 races over the last 27 years. From his first race at Aintree in September 1990 until the last time you saw him flag the way down the Glencrutchery Road. I've lived and breathed every corner of every single race. The British Championships, World Championships, Northwests, Ulster GPs, TTs, Macaus, Star of Darleys, Scarboroughs, Daytonas and more. I've done all the worrying, as well as all the washing. It's what any good wife would do for any good husband. Some women don't make very good racer wives, and some races make for terrible husbands. That little bit of glamour that you might see on the telly takes hard work from both sides. The silence while we wait to hear he's through this or that sector of the TT is even more complete when you're the closest person to him. The crashes, the wins, the deaths, and all the miles in between. I've laughed and cried with John all the way. I'm the person that sees the John McGuinness that John doesn't want anyone else to see. Sometimes John doesn't even want to see that John himself. I've seen every side of him, whether I've wanted to or not. I've been with John since I was 13, and I'm now 41. I've supported him through thick and thin, for richer and definitely for poorer. He went wild for a few years, and it was a real challenge keeping up with him. Good men like David Jeffries provided a calming influence and helped keep him on, or at least near, the right track. John's biggest problem is that he has the mental age of a 12-year-old. If you think I'm joking, you should have seen him on a recent family day out to York. He spotted a donut stand and decided there and then that he needed one of his own. All day he was talking about getting one, trying to convince our 15-year-old son Ewan and anyone else who'd listen. I can understand my son thinking it might be a good idea, but when your 44-year-old husband looks you dead in the eyes and tells you that we need a McDonut stand so that he can earn a living on the side from racing, it's as hard to accept as it is ridiculous. I've been watching these kind of episodes unfold for the last 27 years, and they've never got any better. If anything, they've got worse. He does make me laugh, though, which is just as well, because if I didn't laugh, I'd go nuts. Shared laughter is one of the major reasons we're still together. Life is very serious and too much horrible stuff goes on, so it's essential. That said, I would have served less time for murder. In fact, I could have actually murdered him, been released, and still had a life in that time we'd been together. Living with John is easy. All that's required is loving him, racing, and motorbikes so much that you'd be willing to live in a freezing cold tin van on the beach in Morecambe in winter. When we had to do that, it was just another adventure, another twist and turn in our journey. Those low points had to happen for us to be able to experience the high points, like when we lived in Saint-Tropez in the same tin van. Lying on the beach and taking water taxis around the bay, or jumping on the scooter with our son when he was a baby, were rewards for putting up with the cold a few months before. You could say we were irresponsible, but I think most people are when they're young. Also, John's perception of danger on or off a bike is different from nigh on every other person's on the planet. If he feels safe, he's going to do something, and maybe part of that has rubbed off on me and how we live. We live with risk day in and day out. I don't think there's a downside to living with John, aside from the odd tantrum. When he gets on a bike, he's a god. Bikers all over the world worship him, wherever we are. But to me, he's my little drama queen. To be fair, in all those races over all those years, the only place I've ever really seen him stressed is in the TT. By the Tuesday of race week in 2016, he wanted to go home. He was absolutely, completely and utterly deflated. His workload was massive, the bike wasn't as competitive as he'd hoped, and things were spiralling out of control. Only John can control that. I can be there to help him, but he has to deal with certain situations on his own. He did. He always does. People have told me over the years that I need to persuade him to give up racing. How can I do that? Who am I to tell him that he has to give up what he enjoys doing most in the world? Nobody has the right to do that to him. Not his wife, or his family, or anyone else. That's my opinion on his racing, and maybe that's why we work together. I don't control John. I just do his washing. Make sure the holes in his jeans aren't too big, and point him at the shower now and then. He's worked harder than most people will ever understand to live the life you're about to read about. I hope you enjoy reading it as much as we've enjoyed living it. Becky McGuinness, December 2016. Chapter 1. Moonhead Baby. I was born on 16th of April 1972 at the Queen Victoria Hospital in Morecambe. I was delivered using forceps and weighed 8 pounds 6 ounces, most of which was made up by my huge head. I was basically pulled out of my mother by an enormous set of mole grips. Apparently, back in the early 70s, the normal thing to do was to put you in an incubator when you first arrived. When they carried me back to me mum, after I'd been cleaned up and sorted out, she took one look at me and said, "What's that?" I had a massive head which, even after half an hour in the incubator, was still covered in marks from the mole grips. They told her I clearly hadn't wanted to come out yet, and that it'd taken a fair bit of work to pull me out. Me and my mum still laugh about how shocked she must have been when she realised she'd given birth to a baby with a moon head. Less than 2 miles from the hospital was 52 Granville Road, the McGuinness family home at the time. A three-bedroom terraced house. It's 2 streets back from the promenade in Morecambe and less than 10 minutes from where you catch the ferry to the Isle of Man. My dad, John McGuinness Sr., was working on the tools in a bike shop in Morecambe when I was born. My mum, Christine, has always worked. She's a Trojan, a proper grafter. She worked at a place called Cannon Hygiene, managing toilet rubbish facilities and chemicals. I can't remember too much about the early days, but from what I've been told, I spent a lot of my time getting dropped off at my nana's house while my mum and dad were out working. The
connection I have. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.